I also take the opportunity to welcome you all here. I'm really pleased to have a full room and from people from all over the world. So it's really a pleasure to see our community growing and having meetings in nice places now on the north of Germany, but with a kind of a tropical climate. So it's an interesting mixture. So I just want to briefly report on the meeting that we have on the last couple of days, from Monday to Tuesday lunchtime. We got together more than 30 people from several countries from Asia, Australia, Europe, Latin America, and North America to discuss around our vision and what we need to do technically, mostly from the technical part, but from the technical and human part to help to promote our vision and to implement our vision of distributed infrastructure that is based on the network of existing repositories, and that infrastructure will support scholarly communication and open science. And we just have this inspiring talk from Klaus, so thank you also for that. I think it's important to stress this because our vision is a vision of distribution of infrastructure, distribution of control, because that is also the way that we can secure that that infrastructure and that system can really reflect and be sensitive to the diversity that we have, diversity of requirement, of needs, of development stages, of the different regions, of the different disciplinary communities, etc., rather than relying on the centralized services and platforms. And we know that is always very tempting, because also it's kind of easy to rely on centralized solutions. But we really think that the power of our solution and also the challenges of our solution is the network shape, is the distributed nature of what we are proposing. And so what we aim to do during these 2 days was to first also to bring us all to the same page and to really understand what is going on around the world, to discuss and share information about the current situation of the different networks, what type of services and functionalities they are already providing, what are also the best practices, and what are the strategies and the actions that at national and regional level are being used to build community of practices. We wanted also to discuss what should be the strategies for the adoption of the next generation repository functionalities at the network level, and then also to discuss priorities for cooperation and interoperability across networks. So we had an agenda during these 3 days that was focused on this main point. So we started about half a day to really present what was going on around the world. So what is being done currently at metadata aggregation, validation, curation, text and data mining, discovery, dashboards, etc. By the way, I think, and that's also a very good thing, you will have the opportunity to hear tomorrow most of what has been also presented in the our meeting about the current state of development of the regional and national networks. Tomorrow we'll have sessions where most of it, or even probably even more detailed information, will be presented. So you will have the opportunity to learn what we have also learned on the meeting on Monday and Tuesday. And secondly, we also presented and discussed briefly the next generation repository vision, but focus on the question of the network services. And the final topic of presentations was sharing experiences on community building. So we have some presentations from Europe, from Japan, on this community building experiences. And finally, we have a slot for discussion. And from that discussion, we focus mainly on three main aspects. One was the technical aspects and the interoperability, so the interoperability and technical developments. The second topic was international community building and alignment, because we also, during the discussion, it was clear that, for instance, if we want to have some of the services and then functionalities or the behaviors that we are trying to promote on the in our next generation repository vision, we need stronger alignment, cooperation, and coordination at the international level. So this is really a challenge that we need to address. And finally, the third point, also very important point, is capacity building. It's very important that we recognize that networks are at different stages of maturity. Repositories are in different regions of the world are also in different stages of maturity. And we there was a very interesting say yesterday. That's also a took home message that I think it was Iman from Africa that said that they want to start where we stopped. So they want to start from not doing what we have already done, not doing the same mistakes or going through the same pains from what we already that we have already experienced, but start from what we have where we already are. So this, but to do that, really, it's very important to share experience and to build capacity and to help to build capacity at national, regional, and global level. So there was a lot of discussion. This was only the first meeting, and I already kind of announcing that we will plan to have others. But we have some practical outcomes. One of them, we realized that there are several aggregator initiatives, and for instance, Klaus slightly, Klaus referred to OpenAIR, to CORE. There is La Referencia in Latin America. There is BASE here in Germany. Japan is also aggregation service. So, and others are developing also aggregation services. So we think it will be useful not to avoid to reinventing the wheel. Of course, there'll be different aggregation services for different purposes, for different communities. But I think we thought that there is at least two things that can be certainly done and are useful. One is sharing information between the people that are working and developing those services. And the other one is to facilitate the data sharing across networks. That is already happening. So La Referencia and OpenAIR are already doing that, but we can do it probably in a more at more scale and on a more structured way. And a third point, that's something that is not clear if it will come to have real impact. But I think at least it's worthwhile to explore the possibilities of collaboration and joint or shared developments of the aggregator services. So if one, because now these portals and aggregators are doing not just discovery, they are doing, some of them are developing dashboards and broker systems, others are doing recommenders, and probably we can have, we could imagine that there could be some collaboration or eventually even some specialization and sharing the results of each of them. And finally, and I must admit, this is more from discussions on the afternoon, then we have some meetings with some networks on the afternoon. This is also something that was raised yesterday morning, but yesterday afternoon after the strategic meeting that Martha will report in a minute. We also discussed the question of guidelines and the need for kind of internationalization of guidelines. So I think it will. This is also something that is very aspirational for CORE. We are trying to promote it for a couple of years now, so trying to develop some kind of global guidelines that can then have local and regional application profiles. So you will not, because of course, again, needs are different and are diverse, but if we can have a common global guidelines for repositories and for metadata and repositories that can then be adapted to the local needs, I think that will be a very useful thing. On the second aspect of international alignment and community building, we just come up with basically two things. One is, I think we will, everyone agree that the meeting was very useful, so we will repeat the meeting probably jointly again with the next year annual meeting. So you need to wait until tomorrow morning to know where. I will not tell you now. And the second aspect is to explore ways to share information on national and regional developments through the core website or other side. We also need to from the core side evaluate what and assess what this means also for on terms of workload. So we will do that. But there are, for instance, during the discussions yesterday, there were several documents and experience that were mentioned that people find useful, people from Europe were not aware of things that were being done in Asia or in Africa or in Latin America and the other way around. So we need to secure that there is more information sharing of what is going on. And finally, on the third topic of community of capacity building. Again, is also this question of disseminating through core or even using other platforms. And I'm also thinking, for instance, for training, we might also partner with other projects, relevant resources like guides, recommendations, best practices, and use cases, and training materials that will help to create capacity and be used for training repository managers and librarians, etc., in different parts of the world. And one other thing is also the possibility of kind of developing a common curriculum for training repository managers. We will have an experience already in July in conjunction with Duraspace. We are organizing a training, and I think maybe from there we can try to see if we can come up with a kind of generalized curriculum or framework for replicating this kind of training elsewhere. And finally, I must say that, because otherwise Jean-Claude Guédon will not forgive me, there was an elephant in the room that was researched, that was all highly discussed. It was researchers. So how to involve them on the transformation of the scholarly communication system that we are really promoting? Because there's also a lot of discussion, because of there is a kind of strange situation where the researchers are receiving, as also Klaus mentioned, are receiving lots of messages saying that they should be open, but at the same time they have all the incentives not to, and so they in many cases they might not be very interested on these tools of openness that we are building. So we need to be secure that we are building things not for ourselves, but we are building things for researchers, and most of it for science and for open science, for promoting the public good and common good, that is open science. And this is it for me.
It was great to be at the strategic meeting. And for those of you who aren't familiar with this, it's really an opportunity for a sort of big ideas framing of the issues that are on everybody's minds. It was yesterday afternoon, about 2 hours, and I think there were about 15 of us. And I would invite any of you who were there to jump in. I don't think I can do justice to everything that was captured in that time, but I'll try. So really, as I said, it's about, you know, what drives us, what brings us together, and we had a number of questions that Kathleen had posed for us. We had representatives from a bunch of different regions, and really these were topics where we wanted to get the perspectives of each of our different regions. So we had Africa, South America, Asia, North America, and Europe. And the first topic we talked about was moving funds from subscriptions to local, regional, and national infrastructures and services. So of course, this strikes a chord for all of us. We have a vision of where we want to go with our open repositories, and that has been driven by, in many years, by issues around our subscriptions, our traditional scientific publishing mechanisms. So the big deals are often on many of our minds. So we talked a little bit about the issues of the big deals and the packaging of titles that, of course, leaves us with no flexibility for our curation and decision making, and that with the continually rising licensing costs doesn't bode well for us. I spoke a little bit about a project that we've had in Canada building on research of Vincent Lariviere at Université de Montréal. This was a study that started out with a few universities in Quebec and then broadened to 28 institutions across the country. And basically we used his methodology that looked at all of our journal packages across all of our big deals. Looked at the number of downloads for particular journals, number of citations, and surveyed researchers on their impressions of the 10 most popular titles for them for research and then for teaching. So we've analyzed that, and you may have heard these statistics. We found that for the Springer package, as an example, only 15% of the titles are actually used by our researchers. So those were impressive numbers for us to be able to take forward to our researchers at our institutions. And it gets better when you think about the fact that we have perpetual access to older titles, and so essentially we're paying very high costs for the more current pieces of literature. So at my own institution, we have done analysis that shows for some of those downloads, we could be paying as much as $10,000 per download. So once we're telling our researchers that, they're saying, I pay $35, so you know what's going on here? So it's opening up a lot of good conversations. It's leading to some modification of approaches. We're looking at selective title purchases. We heard from one institution that is really, in a concerted way, purchasing back files to secure that ongoing access. And as I say, that really highlights the cost that we're paying for new content. The group talked about this first as a budget issue, and things like the foreign exchange issues that we've faced in say, Canada and Australia really highlighted this for us a few years ago. But of course, if you go back, we've been talking about this issue for decades. And the concern is that if the budget pressure is released, that we'll go back to thinking this is all fine. We don't want that to be the case. I think what we really want to say is that this isn't a budget issue, it's about the effective use of public funds. So that led to some interesting conversations about things like decolonizing collections. I think we're often thinking about that, both in the Global South and in our own local contexts. And of course, the issue of the effective use of public funds for open access that is truly open access, and we're not dealing with hybrid journals, for example. There was an interesting conversation, a focus on a phrase that I really liked about thinking of each of our countries as a center of knowledge. So rather than turning to external publishers, let's think about our own responsibilities, that mantra we all have about repatriating scholarly publishing to the academy. So that really resonated. And then that led to the discussion about national infrastructure and services. So I'm sure you're all aware, the concept here is how can we really take the funding that we've been using for traditional acquisitions and increase expenditures on infrastructure? So, not simply the flip model that we hear about, but really, really changing the system and thinking about how we can do things differently. So one example we talked about there was SCOS, Global Sustainability Coalition for Open Science Services. And I know from looking at their website this morning that a lot of you are already supporting this initiative. It is a community-led effort to help maintain and ultimately, hopefully, secure vital infrastructure that can support a publishing landscape that really does move that bar on open to it being the default. There's a fee structure that has a range of different costs for anybody who wants to sign up. And as you might know, they identify a couple of projects that seem worthy of funding. The current two projects on the table are DOAJ and Sherpa Romeo. But that's a three-year funding, and then ongoing there will be other opportunities to decide what you as an institution or organization would like to support. And Martin Borkett is here. Where is he? There he is. Okay. Martin, University of New South Wales, is actually the chair of that committee, which is a Spark Europe initiative. So talk to him if you want to know more. So that was all about really this idea of the rise of the publishing platform. And that refers to next generation repositories. Also, I think thinking of working with entities like the Public Knowledge Project, which wants to look at new models that it can develop as well. But really, I guess essentially it's that idea of moving into these collaborative platforms and thinking about, you know, the funding that we're spending on those external commercial entities. Why are we doing that? Let's try and move things towards these better alternatives. We talked a bit about the Cielo platform, which we all admire as a great standard for all of us to think about, but we talked about the issue there of wanting to put more accredited journals onto that platform, and the idea that, in fact, there's an attraction still to the international journals that sit well outside that Cielo platform. And so, of course, that was our next topic, really, was addressing the issue of over-reliance on impact factor and journal-based metrics for research assessment. That really is the crux of the issue. Klaus mentioned it as well, that sense that for those scientists in Brazil, yes, there's an attraction to supporting the local publishing platform, but really, for tenure and promotion, they still need to be thinking about the other options. And so we heard that publishing in a Cielo journal gets you 6 points in your tenure process, but an international journal gets you 10, okay. Okay, I'm getting corrected about my facts here. Okay. Anyway, the point is that there's still a ways to go in thinking about how we incentivize all of this. So those are the three main thrusts, and I think they do sort of represent for our community the key issues that we all are thinking about in this landscape. And I thought I would just give you three things to think about as we go forward. And they were things that we touched on in the discussion, but really I think the point of this was to kind of launch us for the next day and a half for all of us to be thinking about. So first of all, how do we strengthen the repository networks in each of our regions so that we can be part of this global knowledge commons? Klaus mentioned digital culture. I think that's key for us, working together to develop the appropriate incentives. Really, that's where what it all comes down to, and how do we manage that collectively. And then finally, I think there was already a mention of this, engaging researchers in the development of new platforms and incentives. None of this happens without that strong partnership across a variety of different stakeholders, and we all have to come together to make these things happen.